Miles Davis's Kind of Blue is the highest selling jazz record of all time. It's also my personal favorite. Each song on this recording is a masterpiece. We as bass players need to be very familiar with several of them. So let's learn one of them today. Let's go today to a summary of how to play all blues. Welcome to Learn Jazz Bass with Matt Rubicki. If you're interested in finding out more about how to play jazz bass, please subscribe to my channel. Like this video if you would, and also check below for a link for a free PDF related to today's lesson. Before we go on with specific notes, let's listen to the recording and I'll play along so that you can get it in your ear. So now that it's in our ear, why don't we take a look at specifically what notes Paul Chambers is playing on this recording. The very first one is the low G on the E string, and I am playing this with my pinky on the upright bass. That is because the other fingers can help to get the strongest sort of grasp of the neck, especially for these low notes. Now on electric, this is going to be your third fret, so this is G natural. And then the next note is going to be D natural. And then the next note is going to be E natural. The next two notes are D natural again and F natural. So G, D, E, D, F. Open D again. E natural again, D natural again. That completes the whole phrase. Start again. G, D, E, D, F, D, E, D, G, D, E, D, F, D, E, D, G. And for the turnaround, which means that it's the section of the song that gets us back to the sort of the home base. In this case, it's G7, and this would be in bars 9 and 10. It's D7 to E-flat 7, and then D7 in bar 10, and that's just open D. The E-flat is, I'm playing with my first finger, which is right here. This would be the first fret on electric bass. Open D again. And then back to the riff. All right? So if we're gonna count it in six, one and two and three and four and five and six and one and two and three and four and five and six and one and two and three and four, five and six and one. And then for the turnaround, one and two and three and four and five and six and one, two, three, four, five, and six, and one, and two, and three, and four, and five, and six, and one. And that's pretty much it for the entirety of the song, at least the way that they recorded it. But you know, jazz music is about taking something and making it your own. There's many ways you can play this. I mean, for sure, technically, you can finger this a different way. You could start with your second finger on the G here. One, two, open one, open two. Like that. In Miles's famous second great quintet, they played this song as part of their repertoire, but they played it much faster. And to sort of accommodate the speed, the master bass player, Ron Carter, played the whole line up an octave and sort of swallowed or ghosted some notes. That sounded kind of like this. Sort of like that. But again, it's up to you to make this line your own, especially when you're creating music with other people. So it's important that we listen, transcribe not only Paul Chambers' version, but other versions, but then also take that in, live with it, right? And then do something different with it. That's part of what this music is all about. So now you know one of the essential jazz bass lines in the jazz canon. All Blues is a masterpiece, like I said earlier. Here's some interesting things about this recording before we say goodbye for today. In Miles Davis's autobiography, he mentions that he was trying to emulate the sound of an African thumb piano on this record. While it doesn't sound very much like it, what the piano is doing could very well be something like what he was trying to get to. It's a little unclear which song in particular he was talking about. Also, I want to point out that there is an interlude in the head of this song. By head, I mean the main melody or the main theme. Usually in a blues, the form is 12 bars long, and that happens here during the solos. But in the head, there's actually an extra 4 bars that they stay on that G7 vamp. A lot of times when people play this live, they don't play this, nor did they maybe really even notice that that happens. I've included it on the chart though, so that you know for sure. Another thing to point out is what's called a compound chord in bar 5. Normally in a blues, you would go to the 4 chord. Here that's C7 in a G blues. And you can see that C7 on top of the chord symbol. But the bass does not change. It actually stays on that basic bass line, implying a G7. So I've placed it into what's called a compound chord. One chord is played by the horns and the piano. The bass stays on G7. Oftentimes, this is performed incorrectly when people play it at jam sessions and so on. That's something of note. Another thing is what's called a turnaround. This is how we get back to the one chord. This would be in measures 9 and 10. You'll notice that it's a D7 and then an E-flat 7 sharp 9 and a D7 sharp 9. This is different than the very, very traditional blues where it would be 5 to 4 or D7 to C7. Or a 2-5-1, where it would be A minor 7 to D7, going back to G7. So this is a little bit unusual as well. Lastly, I wanted to point out that when you listen to certain recordings of this piece, extended editions and so on, you'll hear bassist Paul Chambers say something to the effect of how hard it was for him to be playing that the whole time. I'm sure that that was under Miles' direction, and while the line isn't that hard, it's pretty tough to keep it up for 7 or 8 minutes. And of course, he did it wonderfully because Paul Chambers is amazing. So once again, thanks for watching. Please remember to like and subscribe. Check out that link for the free PDF below. And remember, straight ahead and strive for tone.